Hello, my name is Jason Johnson, and thank you for watching this video. Hope you find all my videos helpful, and thank you for subscribing to my channel. If you have a question or feedback, you can leave a comment, and I'll try to answer as quickly as possible or try to point you in the right direction with an answer. Okay, so this video covers the Cisco Netacad CCNA Course 1, Chapter 10, Part 2. That's a mouthful. The CCNA Course 1 for routing and RNS, Netacad, part 2 for chapter 10, and the first part of the video, first part video is in the description below. So let's get started here with part 2 of this video, and we're going to be talking about well-known application layers, protocols, and services, and then we're going to do a summary for both, or for the full chapter 10. First, we're going to look at well-known application layer protocols and services. When we look at this, you should be able to explain by the end of the video or by the end of this core or the end of this chapter in the course that you're taking how web and email protocols operate, how IP addressing protocols operate, and then explain how file transport protocols transfer. I said transport. File transfer protocols operate. So first, web and email protocols. When we do a website, we have what we call HTTPS or Hypertext Transfer Protocol and Hypertext Markup Language or HTML. To get a web page displayed in your browser, that web page has to be created in a format. Usually it's similar to a text file. You can read it with a text reader, in most cases with the simple HTML. And that file is written in a language that can be read by the browser. So some common terms that we need to know about this is a web address or a URL, a uniform resource locator, the URL. That's a reference to a web server. So a web server will have a URL name, for example, cisco.com. The URL is the name of most people associate with web addresses. So if we think about cisco.com, microsoft.com, apple.com, you know, things like that, that's the URL. And the great thing about the internet is we can use names to get to web pages instead of having to remember the IP address, which we'll cover here a little bit later in the video. But that URL has three parts to it. We have the HTTP, and that's the protocol, either HTTP or HTTPS, whether it's encrypted. But that's the protocol. We have the server name, and that's the www, and you usually don't have to put in the HTTP and the www. Most browsers will compensate for that and put that in for you. But you have the server name, and that's the World Wide Web or www. We have the name Cisco, in this case, cisco.com. And then we have the file name being requested. Usually you don't put in the index.html because the browser assumes that it's looking for an index.html or the home page. The home page is the index.html. That is going to tell you where all the other information is located. It's going to be your landing page, and that's going to get pulled up. We put in that file name, or the, not the file name, we put in our server name, cisco.com, for example. But what happens is that server has an IP address on it, and our browser is looking for a particular IP address because we're using IP addressing in scheme of our networking that we're doing here. So DNS, or domain name service, is the server name portion of the URL, and it's translated to an associated IP address before the server can be contacted. So you don't see that usually in the browser side. The browser looks for a DNS service. It either can be located locally, or it can be located on a DNS server out on the internet. But your service looks for a DNS, and it tries to translate that cisco.com to an IP address, and then that gets translated and then sent to the or pulls the file down from the server. Now, what happens is in the background, or from the networking standpoint, a GET task or a GET request is sent to the server's IP address, and it asks for the index.html file. And when it asks for that, the server sends the requested file. You might be looking for page one, page two, page three. Sometimes you're trying to go to a particular page on that web server. But in this case, we're just looking for the index.html file. That file is specified in the URL, and it contains HTML code for that web page. It's going to give header information, it's going to say the body, it's going to say how it's formatted, and that browser, it should be written in a language that's formatted that browser can read. And so then the browser processes the file, it processes the code, and then it formats the page so that you, the user, can read that. So then you end up getting that page looking like, for the Cisco.com page, and you get that in a format that you can read. Now, there's three. There's two different types. I mentioned earlier HTTP and HTTPS. The HTTP, some characteristics of that is that that's the request response protocol. There's three common messages that it uses: the GET, the POST, and the PUT. Now, if you want to read more about those, you can. That's, I think that's in the course reading material. I don't cover it here in this video, but there are three different types of messages. It is not secure, and that's the thing to understand. It is not secure, and messages can be intercepted. And in this course, you learn how to do Wireshark or wire sniffing, and you sniff those packets, and HTTP is not secure, and you can read somebody's web page that they're sending through. Now, what we've done in the networking world is they've come up with encryption, and they have the HTTPS, and that's encryption to secure data before it's sent across the network so that it cannot be intercepted and broken into easily. Now, when we're talking about, let's shift over to email protocols here. Now, email, all of us have probably sent email through either Google or Yahoo or some other type of email service, or you've used Outlook or some other Thunderbird or something like that. But what we do is we create an email, we forward it through, and we don't think about the background of what's happening. But email is a store and forward method of sending, storing, and retrieving email or electronic messages. They're stored in a database on mail servers. So if I'm going to create an email to somebody, as a sender, I create that message and I give it my, you know, the user at Cisco.com, and it goes to my router, it goes to the internet, and it goes up to whatever mail server I'm using. It goes and sets up on a mail server. And then that gets transferred using the SMTP service over to the user's mail service. It looks for Cisco.com and it says, I'm trying to send an email to that server. And then it takes and stores it on that mail server until that user logs on and says, hey, I need to get my mail. In a simple way to put it. So email clients communicate with the mail server to send and receive email. Mail servers communicate with each other to send messages back and forth. And then email clients do not communicate directly with sending email. So clients do not communicate directly when sending email. You send it and it goes to a server, and you let the servers do the work passing those messages back and forth. And so email relies on three separate protocols: SMTP for sending, POP and IMAP for retrieving. SMT, and this is important. You need to know these. SMTP is for sending. That's their protocol. POP protocol for retrieving, and IMAP for retrieving as well. And we're going to look at all three of those here on these next few slides. So at the SMTP operation, this is the sending operation. SMTP formats required message header and information in the body. The body can contain any amount of text. It can have the text on there. We can also attach photos and things like that. Sometimes you might have attached a video or something like that, or you put a link to a website or something like that. But we put that information in there. The header has to have a properly formatted recipient email address and a sender address, so it knows what mail server it's going to. You might have received an email back from time to time where it says, cannot reach this sender or cannot reach this user, because the user either wasn't set up on the mail server or that you had a wrong email address on there. But the SMTP client sends mail by connecting to the server on port 25. The server receives the message and stores it in a message local mailbox and relays that message to another mail server, sends it on. So the users use email clients to retrieve messages stored on the server. You don't directly talk to the server. Your client does that. And so the IMAP and the POP are the protocols used by clients to retrieve messages. And there's some differences between those two, between IMAP and POP. And we're going to take a look at those here next. So the POP operation is messages are downloaded from the client or from the server to the client at the request of the client. It's not a push operation. The POP email doesn't pop up on your phone and say, hey, I've got mail for you. You have to go and retrieve it. So your client has to say, I need to go pull my messages down. So the server listens on port 110 and it listens for request, and it says, okay, are any clients asking for any emails? Or any of my, you know, on that. So the email clients direct the POP request to the mail server on port 110, and the client and server exchange commands and responses until the connection is closed or aborted, and they send that message through. So the recipient here says, hey, do I have any email out there? Our sender sends it. It goes to this server here. This server sends it to this one, and it sets here on this server until the recipient says, hey, do I have any mail? You go to the mailbox and check your mailbox. And then so it pulls that email down. Now, the thing about POP is there's no centralized location where email messages are kept. So once that recipient downloads that email, it gets removed from the mail server. So messages reside on the device that triggered the download. So now that email that got sent is residing right here. Now the sender's got a copy of it, but the recipient, it's no longer on the mail server. So if I come in here as with another client, if I have another, let's say I have a mobile phone here as my client and I download that message through POP, and I have another, let's say that I have a tablet and I try to download messages, it's not going to pull it down because it's already been removed off the server. Now, there's some settings you may say to yourself, well, how do we do it? Well, there's some settings to tell it to leave messages on the server, but it's not that's a setting that has to be done. But by default, when you remove that message, it removes it from the server. So now let's look at the difference between that and IMAP. The IMAP service is another protocol. It's used to retrieve email messages as well. It allows messages to be displayed to the user rather than downloaded. So you're really displaying the message and not downloading it. So the original messages reside on the server until manually deleted by the user. So POP removes that message off the server and downloads it. IMAP leaves it on the server and just reads it and says, okay, until I delete it off my client and tell it to delete it off the server, it's not going to delete it. So if you come in with another client, let's say that I opened up my mobile phone and checked my messages, and then I opened up my tablet and checked my messages, it's going to be in both locations. So you can view copies of that message, and users can create a folder hierarchy using IMAP, and the file structure is displayed on the email client. And when a user decides to delete a message, the server synchronizes that action and deletes the messages from the server and any other clients that gets removed off those as well. So that's the difference between POP and IMAP. And remember, SMTP is your sending service. Now, when we're talking about IP addressing and domain name service, or DNS, and you'll hear it called DNS, IP addresses are crucial for network communication. We have to have IP addressing to communicate, but they're not easy to memorize. I can't remember 192.168.10.1 and what website did that go to. So what we have come up with in the networking world, or I didn't, but it was designed so that we have domain names, and they're created to make server addresses a lot more friendly. So think about it from a telephone. So instead of, you know, giving my telephone number out and, you know, 555-123-5496, I can just say, hey, call me up at Jason Johnson. You know, and you can just put in your phone, Jason Johnson, you call me that way. That's what happens with web addressing. Well, we don't have that with a phone system. So domain names such as Cisco.com are user-friendly. They're associated with that. So you can put on a business card, Cisco.com. You don't have to give out the IP address. You can change your IP address. You can change your IP addressing. You can change the host of your ISP. And all you have to do is change your DNS service to point the IP address to the correct domain, or the domain to the correct IP address. And so computers still need the actual numeric address before they can communicate. They have to have the IP address, so we use the domain name service. And so what happens is the domain or DNS protocol, it allows for translation of that. So a client says, hey, I'm trying to get to Cisco. I'm trying to get to Cisco.com. I don't have the IP address. I just have Cisco.com. So that browser says, hey, let me go check the DNS server. And the DNS server says, hey, yes, I do. I know that Cisco.com belongs to 198.133.219.25. And it gives me that information. And now my client has the right IP address, and it can send the request based on the IP address with the networking. So it resolves. It changes, or what we call a resolution, or it resolves a name to an IP address is the best way to think about it. Now, the DNS message format supports different types of records. Some of those record types are A, that's an end device for an IPv4 or V4 address. AAAA, that's an end device with IPv6, or what we call pronounced quad A. And MX is a mail exchange record, so that we can, you know, we're sending it to recipient at Cisco.com, that is the MX record, lets us resolve the email address to an IP address as well. So the response, DNS servers first look for their own records, so you can keep DNS servers locally inside your system to resolve names, and that speeds the process up. A lot of companies do that, or companies will do that, let me say it that way, so that they have DNS servers, because that cuts down on bandwidth out to the internet. And so the servers, if it's unable to resolve it locally, it will send it out to the internet, to a DNS server on a DNS service. And so the DNS client on the Windows also stores. So you have a DNS, and you can go into your Windows service and go IP config and display DNS, and it'll show all of your entries or your cached DNS entries that you, the websites that you've been to or that you've resolved. Now, the hierarchy, when we talk about the DNS hierarchy, we break down domain names, and I'm not going to really cover it in depth here other than just say you have domain name levels. We have top-level domains, and those are things like .com, .org, .au for Australia, .us for the United States, .biz. Those are top-level domains, and then we have the regular secondary domain servers. That would be like a Cisco.com, and then we have the DNS client. So the .com, .org, so you could set up a Cisco.com and a Cisco.org, and both of those, and then they would point those to the right IP addressing, or like a mail.cisco.com on that as well. You can also do a NS lookup. The NS lookup command on a Windows system will let you look up an IP address. It will help you resolve, or you let me say it this way. You can use the NS lookup command to resolve a domain name to an IP address. So it can be used to troubleshoot name resolution issues if you're having trouble. Sometimes, you know, you can look up to see, is a server operating? You know, is it located properly on there? Or if you want to know an actual IP address of a server, you can do that. So you can go Cisco.com, and it's going to say, okay, here's the different IP addresses that we show. You know, I'm showing this one here, and I'm showing this one here. For Netacad.com, here I'm showing these IP addresses. So that's a way to show the resolution on that. Now let's switch gears and talk about file sharing services real quick, and then we'll wrap up Chapter 10 here in this video. So DHCP, so when we assign IP addressing to our computers, we have a service called DHCP, or Dynamic Host Configuration Protocol. Computers need to have the IP addressing to communicate over a network. We can either put those in manually, or we can use a service like DHCP. And DHCP, what that does is we set up a group or a pool. We set up a pool of IP addresses, and those get passed out to clients. So what happens is, and I'm going to switch to the next screen here. What happens is a client says, "Hey, I need an IP address. I need a DHCP server to give me an IP address." So it pings out on the network, and it sends out a DHCP discover, and it says, "I need a DHCP. I need an IP address." If it finds a server, the server replies with a DHCP offer and says, "Hey, I'm a server. Here's your IP information." And so then it sends a DHCP request to it, or it sends a discover. It gets an offer back. It sends a request to say, "Hey, I need that IP information." And so the server passes it out. It passes that information out for a certain amount of time. And so the server says, we'll respond with a DHCP acknowledgement. If the offer is no longer valid, it'll send a NAC out. Leases must be renewed. So a DHCP server will set a release for a certain amount of time, whether it's 24 hours or maybe 72 hours or something like that. And then during that time, the client will start saying, "Hey, can I still have this DHCP address?" And it'll say, "Yes, you can still have it," and it'll renew that over time. If the DHCP client goes offline for, let's say, 30 days and comes back online, it will say, "Hey, the last time I was online, here was my IP addressing information. Can I still have that?" If the server has not given that IP address out to another client, it will just renew it, and it'll renew it and continue to go on. If not, it will give it all new IP information on there. And then when we talk about V6, it has similar set of messages. It has solicit, advertise, information request, and reply on there. Now, a file transfer protocol, or FTP. FTP is a service where we can move files across the network. It's an old protocol. I mean, it's been around for a long time. I used that back with bulletin board systems back in the early 90s. FTP was developed to allow transfer of files over the network. It runs on a client computer used to push and pull data to an FTP server. It requires two connections between the client and the server. One connection is for commands and replies, and the other is for the actual file transfer protocol. And you have two ports that handle that operation. And you need to memorize these. You need to know these for exams, for this course and for other just in networking in general. TC port 21 establishes the connection and the server for control, and TCP port 20 is for data transfer. So you need to memorize those. Port 21 is for establishing connection and control, and 20 is for transferring data. And the client can download pull data to the server and push data to the server. So it can pull it down or push it up. So that's in the past, I've used FTP servers to push web pages up when I was designing web pages. And what I would do is there would be an FTP server setting on that web server, and I could then upload my files to the FTP server. That would then be on the web server, and then the web server they could then offer those up to clients. Okay, and server message block is the last one we're going to look at. SMB, is a shortcut, or what we call this, is SMB. It's a client server file sharing protocol. Messages share, SMB messages share a common format. It's for sharing print services. They have a common, or they've become a mainstay of Windows networking, SMB. And so Microsoft products now support TCP/IP protocols to directly support SMB resource sharing. And Mac, Linux, and Unix operating systems have their own implementation of SMB, but they do have it on there. But that's the last one we're going to talk about for this chapter, is the SMB, or server message block. Okay, so we talked about in Chapter 10, we talked about application layer and providing support to end-user applications, and we also talked about well-known TCP/IP applications. We talked about mail protocols. We talked about FTP and all that. So that wraps up Chapter 10. If you have any questions, you can leave a comment below, and I'll try to get back with you as quick as possible. Thank you for subscribing to my channel, and I hope you have a great day.